I do also want to say there is no board meeting tonight for those board members. We're not going to have any meeting tonight. I just want to let you all know that. We had canceled that out. So, Mark, you got the worship service?
Sister Birch, you got a song for us today?
Letting go of every single dream, I laid one down at your feet. Every moment of my wandering never changes what you see. I try to win this war, I confess. My hands are weary, I need your rest. Mighty warrior, king of the fight, no matter what I face, you're by what tomorrow brings. There's not a day ahead you have not seen. So let all things be my life and breath. I want what you want, Lord, and nothing less. When you don't move the mountains, I'm needing you to move. When you don't part the waters, I ask that you walk through. When you don't give the answers as I cry out to you, I will trust in you. I will trust in you. You are my strength and comfort. You are my steady hand. You are my firm foundation.
Awesome. Yeah, so we're in New Year's here tomorrow. I was thinking, New Year, 2024. Isn't that amazing? Hard to believe, too, but they say they get faster as you get older. And I believe that. Somebody said amen. That's right. But all kinds of New Year's resolutions people will be making, thinking about maybe today. Some people will be cooking cabbage. Is that tomorrow today? When is it? And black-eyed peas, isn't that something you do too? Maybe, I don't know. But, you know, the New Year's resolution that people will be talking about losing weight, mental health, different job, all kinds of things. And those will come and go pretty quick. You know, they say that treadmills become a place to hold your clothes. And I believe that sometimes. So, but you know what? Jesus Christ should be a resolution that we're going to improve in serving and telling others about Christ. Can you imagine that? How many people, if we think about it this year, how many people did we actually share the gospel with? How many people did we tell about Christ and about the plan of salvation? How many people in our family did we invite to church? How many people in our workplace did we tell them about Christ? And people that need to know about Christ. When I wasn't saved, you know how many people really came and told me about the gospel? Zero. And you know, I'm guilty of that myself. But to share the gospel should be a resolution that we think of this year. If we could just plant that seed in somebody's mind and live our life in front of them like Christ would want us to live, and stay on that rock and continue to tell people about how God is good to us. And you know, that would be the greatest accomplishment that you could do. If you could just do one and you could lead one to Christ and plant that seed, would be a good New Year's resolution.
You know, before I sing this song, I just want to say that there's no better way to end this year than by singing about the goodness of God, because, you know, with all the bad that's happened this year, he's been that much more good to us. And I could never sing about him enough.
You, Lord, you have led me through the fire and darkest nights. You are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. I have lived in the goodness of God. In the goodness of God. of God.
You know, it says His goodness is running after us in that song, in that scriptural. His goodness is not only good and great, but it's running after us like we're running away from it. And many times we do that, don't we?
Oh, yes. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Anyone have a testimony of the goodness of God? Oh, yes. Hallelujah.
Yes.
Mark asked me to sing this song, and let's just end the year in worship. This precious blood that gives me life, but in 3 years So I come to tell you he's alive, to tell you that he dries every tear that falls. And so I come to tell you that he saves, to shout and to proclaim that he's coming back for you. There is a blood that sights the blind, that heals the sick and the lonely find. It has the power to free the bound as chains they fall. Precious blood that gave me life, but in 3 days he breathed again and he rose to stand in mighty veins. So I come to tell you to tell you that he tried. I don't mean to take up so much of the service, but I just feel like singing this song this morning. I just feel the Holy Spirit's presence so strong in here this morning, and if anybody else needs anything, you know, this altar is always open, and perhaps you feel that, and that's Him drawing you to Him, and please don't turn that away. What better way to start a new year than with a new life in Christ?
Standing by my
praise him one more time.
Before I sing, I want to thank God. I thank God for his mercy. You know, he's there with us through everything we go through. Kathy's going through all this, and you know, God's there. God's there. And, you know, with Lindsay going through what he's going through, so many people going through so much. And, you know, we about lost Michael the other night. You know, you think, well, he just had a couple stents. No, he about died. He said he thought he was dying. You know, God's got plans for that boy if he'll just hold on to God. Our Sunday school lesson was so good this morning. You know, we need to place our confidence in God. God is the answer. You know, we're here for a little while, but you know, God is, he's just so, so good. And you know, with all the things that we go through in life, you know, when I lost my son, that was, I just thought that's the end. This, you know, life's not worth living. But you know, God has brought me not through it. Well, he's brought me through it, but it's painful every day. But, you know, and then you're diagnosed with cancer, and all these things happen in life. That's life. But I just praise God and thanking this morning, whatever you're going through, trust in him. And if you don't know him, oh my, you need to know him. He's the greatest. I just, David wanted me to sing this God on the Mountain, and the little lady that always sung this and done such a good job, she's went on to be with the Lord. And you know, that's what I want to do. I want to go on to be with the Lord one day, and that's what I'm striving for.
Life is easy when you're up on the mountain and you've got peace of mind like you've never known. But then things change. You're down in the valley. Don't lose faith, for you're never alone. For the God on the mountain is still God in the valley. When things go wrong, he'll make them right. For the God of the good times is still God in the night. You talk of faith when you're up on that mountain, and talk comes so easy when life's at its best. But it's down in that valley of trials and temptation, that's when faith is things go wrong, He'll make them right. For the God of the good times is still God in the bad times. The God of the day is still God in the night. The God of the day is still God in the night. Keep hanging on.
All right. Appreciate the great singing today. Appreciate the presence of the Lord. And I still got a word I've got to deliver, so fasten your seatbelts. Hold on. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 17. But I do want to read, I want to read 17, verse 1, then I'll flip it on over into 13. I'd like to hear the pages. Some of you might use your phone with your Bible, and that's fine too, but I'd like to hear the pages of God's Word. I've always taught, when you study the Bible, who, what, when, where, and memorize the Scriptures, and flip that, get familiar with the Bible. Amen. Know the Word of God, and that's the truth, and that's what's very important. Not everybody stands behind the pulpit anymore. There's so much false preaching and false teachings going on. Not everybody's telling you exactly what the Word of God says. So you have to be very careful. Keep your ears in tune with the Spirit, and you need to back it up. Back it up with the Word of God. Know the Word of God. Amen. Let me read something here in chapter 16, because Matthew chapter 16 is a continuation into 17, and that's very important, because I'll read these verses real quickly and then read into 17. And let me read 16:24. Then said Jesus unto his disciples, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it, and whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it. What is a man profited if he gain the whole world and lose his own soul? What shall a man give in exchange for his soul? Listen to this. For the Son of Man shall come in the glory of his Father with his angels. Then he shall reward every man according to his works. Verily I say unto you, there be some standing here which shall not taste death till they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom. Now notice chapter 17, verse 1. And after 6 days, Jesus taketh Peter, James, and John, his brother, and bringeth them up into a high mountain apart. Now let's go to verse 13. Then the disciples understood that he spake unto them of John the Baptist. And when they were come to the multitude, coming down off the mountain, when they were come to the multitude, there came to him a certain man, kneeling down to him and saying, Lord, have mercy on my son, for he is a lunatic, he is sore vexed. For oftentimes he falleth into the fire and oft into the water. And I brought him to the disciples, and they could not cure him. Then Jesus answered and said, O faithless and perverse generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I suffer you? Bring him hither to me. And Jesus rebuked the devil, and he departed out of him, and the child was cured from that very hour. Then came the disciples to Jesus apart and said, why could not we cast him out? And Jesus said unto them, because of your unbelief. For verily I say unto you, if you have faith as a grain of mustard seed, you shall say unto this mountain, remove hence to yonder place, and it shall remove, and nothing shall be impossible unto you. Howbeit, this kind goeth not out but by prayer and fasting. Isn't that interesting? But by prayer and fasting. Here in chapter 17, verse 1, and I just read you that beginning text because It's a continuation. You're coming off of 16, and Jesus is teaching his disciples about how that he is going to suffer, and that how that he would go to the cross of Calvary, and how that they're going to be his followers, how that they too would have to lay down their life. And he said, "What shall it profit if a man gain the whole world and lose his own soul?" But then he teaches them about after that, he said, "Then the Son of God, he shall come in his glory and all of his holy angels and reward those." And then he's telling them on down, he's teaching them about the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ coming back again, the promise of his coming and his return. Then he takes three in the inner circle, chapter 17, verse 1, Peter, James, and John, and they go up onto the mountain. Now notice all the other nine other disciples are down below. He doesn't take them. By the way, not everybody is ready to go up on the mountain. Many people like it right where they are. They like it. It's comfortable down here below. The atmosphere is different, and we stay right where we are. But he picks out now Peter, James, and John, the three men in his inner circle, and he takes them up onto the mountain. While he's up on the mountain, Jesus himself, he changes, we call the Mount of Transfiguration. The glory of the Lord shines through. The inside comes and radiates to the outside, and they see the glory of the Lord. And there with him is not only Peter, James, and John, but there's two other participants, and it is Elijah and Moses. And they're talking with him up on the mount. There they are, the three witnesses is Peter, James, and John, and they're witnessing him, and he is having a conversation with Elijah and Moses here up on this mountain. And we'll talk about a mountaintop experience. Of course, as you all know, there's Peter. The first thing he speaks up, always the one in the bunch, he speaks up out of them and said, "Lord, it's good that we were here." He said, "Would you have us to build three tabernacles?" And he said, "Should we let us make three tabernacles?" And then the cloud, the Shekinah glory, the cloud overshadowed them. And he said from the cloud, the Father said, "This is my beloved Son, hear him, hear him." And when Peter and them went to their knees after they heard the voice of God, they fell up on their face and they fell down upon their knees. And when they looked up, do you know the only one they saw was shining? It's the Son of God. As if God himself, he put the cloud, and he put the cloud in between the S-U-N in nature, and he let the S-O-N shine with all of his glory. See, the only one you really need to see is Jesus Christ and him in his glory. You see him. There's glory. There's various glory. Man has a certain amount of glory. The moon has a certain amount of glory. The sun has a certain amount of glory. A woman has a certain amount of glory. In fact, her hair is called her glory. Amen. But the only one who really gets the glory from God is the Lord Jesus Christ. And he introduces him to the world and said, "This is my beloved Son." In other words, Peter, there's a time to talk and there's a time to listen. And you need to be listening what he's got to say. And it's the Holy Spirit when you get in the presence of Jesus. Talk about a mountaintop experience. Feel like a church service like that when the Holy Spirit is flowing. And he's going down every aisle, every pew, and flowing from breast to breast. And oh, wouldn't we like to dwell on the mountaintop? Maybe like Peter, we want to set up tent here and have a tabernacle. I'd just like to live right here on the mountaintop. Wouldn't that be great? Wouldn't that be wonderful? Well, the mountaintops are wonderful and they're needful in your life, but there's times you had to come out. And this is my title today, to get your head out of the clouds, because you need to come back down to earth. I thank God for his presence. Thank God for his filling. There's nothing any better, and I wish we'd see more of it. I remember a great man of God, W.A. Criswell, preached his last sermon called "Give Me Old Time Religion." And he's talking about the differences in the 30s when he started out as a 13-year-old and up in his 90s when he preached his last sermon down in Texas.
And he said he preached in the church, and he said when an usher came down in the church, and a woman, an elderly woman in the church, she got blessed and filled with the Holy Spirit. The usher came down, wanted to escort her out. Said she was disrupting the service. And everybody else, he said, nobody would make an amen. Nobody even make a peep or anything else in the church service. Everybody's all quiet. And he had to call out to that man, that usher. And he said, no, son. He said, leave her alone. She's filled with the Holy Spirit. But that man didn't know what the filling of the Holy Spirit was. I'm telling you, there's a generation today that talks about the Holy Spirit but doesn't have the Holy Spirit of God. They got a form of godliness but not the power thereof. Something's lacking in our churches. Something's lacking today. It's the presence and the power of God. Well, God's not changed. He's still the same. Jesus is the source of your power. He transfigured himself. Here he was showing to Peter, James, and John in his inner circle. Here's where the power lies. It lies with the Lord Jesus Christ. And you've got to be connected to the power source and know him as your Savior. Many people are professors, but they're not possessors. If you have the Holy Spirit, the Bible says he that hath not the Holy Spirit is none of his. So you mean there's a difference when the Holy Spirit takes up residence inside your heart and your life? Yes. If I let a guest come and stay within our home, do you know what? It changes the atmosphere in that room, in our home. And when Jesus comes in, he changes. The word transfigured there is a word that means metamorphosis, and that's where he goes with the caterpillar, but it's the inside out. It's the changes from the inside out. And that's exactly what the Lord does with us when the Holy Spirit takes up his abode. He starts with the inside, with your heart, gives you a new heart, and he changes, works his way to the outside. But now, it's good to have the mountaintops experience. It's good to have your head. I see some of their head in the clouds. What do you mean by your head in the clouds? I said, well, he's showing them a preview. Peter, James, and John, he's showing them the glory of the Lord and his coming back. He's giving them a preview of what the second coming is going to be. The participants within that are Elijah and Moses. Moses was the one that represents the dead in Christ. He died. God buried him. We don't know where he buried him, but God buried him. He died. And then Elijah represents the prophet of God, the prophet of fire. And he went up with a chariot of fire, and he went up into heaven. And he never saw death. You see, that represents the living and the rapture. And there's two people when the Lord comes back in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 16. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, and the voice of the archangel and the trump of God shall sound, and the dead shall rise. And then we which are alive. So you see the two different men here, Moses and Elijah, representing the dead and the living. And he said they're both caught up to meet the Lord in the air. Well, when he comes with his glory, with his holy angels with him, and he's going to reward all those one day, and all those that have been faithful to serve him. So he's giving them a little preview. After his death, after his burial and after his resurrection, after these things, he's coming back again. He's coming for his church. So he's giving you a preview. They're on the mountaintop. They're experiencing the glory. They're wanting to set up shop. It'd be great to have the servant last and just continue. But then there's a time he said, we got to come down off the mountain. You got to get your head out of the clouds. Some people are always doing this, like Acts chapter 1, verse 11. He said, those two men in white apparel, as Jesus ascended up into heaven, and he ascended up off the Mount of Olives and ascended back into the heaven. And he said, those two men in white apparel said, you men of Galilee, why stand you here gazing? Well, this way some people, they're just gazing. We got our head in the cloud. They're so spiritual. They're so deep. I'm looking for the Lord. The Lord could come in any day. But you're not working. You're not witnessing. You're not worshiping. You're just waiting. I'm waiting. Swing low, sweet chariot. Coming forward to carry me home. Swing low. That's not what the Lord. You see, the mountaintop experience is so you get refueled so you come back down into the valley. There's something down in the valley. That's where sin is. That's where sorrow is. That's where people are in need of a Savior. And that's what the church is supposed to be doing. Peter, James, and John were leaders within the church. And he said, you need to be concerned. I don't want you just here waiting and stargazing up in the heaven. Yes, you're to be watching and praying, but you're having an expectancy in your spirit. I live each and every day expecting the Lord Jesus Christ to return. So you do much more for the Lord. You live a little holier for the Lord when you live with that expectation. Amen. As soon as you get down here, the head in the clouds, some people are so... Some people are so heavenly minded, they're no earthly good. And some people so earthly minded, they're no heavenly good. And boy, where's the church world today? But here we come down, Peter, James, John, here comes Jesus. And since they come down off the mountain, here we're going from the mountaintop. Now we're going back to the valley. Anybody, you have highs and you have lows. And you're going to have in your life, you're going to have a night and you're going to have a day. You're going to have certain things to help maintain balance, and you need, it is needful. And Christians need to be well balanced. Well balanced. Some go overboard, some do underboard, but there's a well balance. And a good pastor is going to rightly divide the Word of God. You got to put this scripture with that scripture over here, and you rightly divide the Word of God and to bring it together so you have a well balanced Christian. And I assure you, if you don't have balance in your life, spiritual balance, then you're going to be off somewhere. But you're going to have highs and lows. You're going to have the mountaintop. You're going to have the valley. You're going to have the high, the low. You're going to have the glory on the mountaintop. And then when you get down the valley, you're going to have the misery. Well, Kathy sang that song, as I wanted her to. And several others did as well this morning with about the mountain and so forth. Some others did there. One other did. But there's a reason. Faith is easy when you're on the mountain. It's down in the valley when your faith is put to the test. It's easy to you see that God is faithful. But are you faithful? It is easy to see sometimes that you can tell somebody else God is your provider. But you've never been tested and you've never lacked anything in your life. You've never been without a check. You've never had no income. But when you don't have anything come in, I want you to tell me then, is God your provider? You've never, if you've never had any sickness in your life, you can tell me he's a great physician. But if you've never had any sickness, can you really tell me he's your great physician? And speak it with conviction? That is, if only the doctor didn't deliver you and bring you out. You see what a difference it makes when you're faced with a test and all of a sudden the reality. You can talk real easy when you're up on the mountain. I'm telling you, God's going to deliver you. But when you're right down there going through it, it's all of a different thing. Notice here the welfare, real quickly, the welfare of this child. I see the welfare as they come down up off the mountain here in verse 14. The disciples, remember nine other, I think a lot of people forget about the nine that was here down below. And here come Peter, James, and John when they were come, verse 14, to the multitude. Remember here was also the crowd. Remember also the Pharisees. They were ridiculing and making fun and stirring things as usual. There came to him a certain man kneeling down to him and saying, Lord, notice this, verse 15, here comes the plead. He's pleading with the Lord. What's he pleading about? He said, have mercy on my son, for he is a lunatic and he is vexed, and oftentimes he falleth into the fire and oft into the water. And I brought him to thy disciples, and they could not cure him. No, they couldn't do anything for him. But he came to Jesus. After they couldn't do anything, he went to Jesus. And here's a father, and he's pleading for his son, the welfare of his son. His health, his financial well-being, that's what welfare means. It means those various things in a combination together. But here, this man here, he's pleading to Jesus about his son. He said he's a lunatic. He's lost his mind. The word lunatic means lunar. In other words, people would look to the moon, and if the moon was just right, it must be a full moon. And people still say it today. If the moon, it must be a full moon out there because somehow it's affecting the way you're behaving. And they blame it on nature. And they look to the signs and the stars. But something's got a hold of this young man. And there's many different kinds. And this sickness is not, it's not a emotional. It's not a financial problem. It's not material. It is a spiritual problem. He has opened up the door and the devil has came in. A demon is possessing this young man. This young man is having epileptic seizures. He literally at times he's foaming at the mouth. He goes into the fire, then into the water. He's hot. He's cold. He's having all sorts of moods and spells upon him. Something's affecting him. He's not thinking straight. Do you know that's exactly, there is a devil. And here he is, the father. He sees the problem here, but the problem is spiritual. This young man has a demon. He has got a demon within him and he's wrecking his life. He's wrecking the young people's life. It is exactly what today. Would that the older people and should be examples to the younger people. Don't do as I say and not as I do. Don't tell someone else what you don't want to do and then you're standing there doing it. Don't be a hypocrite. Why don't you be an example? Why don't you walk if you're going to talk the talk? Why